I'm sorry my upload schedule's been so slow. Life has been getting in the way of this channel a little more than I expected. In this case, though, I'm kinda glad I've been busy lately, haven't been able to get around to reviewing Deadpool. I wasn't sure at first if I really had a whole lot to say about it, especially since digging in and expanding commentary on the subtleties, or lack thereof, would essentially sound like I'm shitting on a movie I ultimately recommend. Not to say I'm about to gloss over things here, but trying to expand the length of the video might have shifted the balance more to the negative side and given the wrong impression. Instead, now that the community and the industry have had a chance to react to the film, it actually opens up some interesting possibilities for the future. But first, back to the film itself. If you know who Deadpool is, or really even if you've just seen the marketing, you know what to expect. Deadpool is famous for his silly, fourth wall breaking sense of humor, and that's really the centerpiece of this film. It's a funny movie, but there really isn't anything more to it than that. Your enjoyment of the film rests with how much you like the rapid fire, irreverent, R-rated sense of humor lining the script. The humor hits home a bit unevenly. There are some really clever moments that had me cracking up, but sometimes it's just, oh, another dick joke. The fourth wall breaks were generally my favorite parts, when he acknowledged he was a character in a movie and used that to poke fun at himself in other comic book movies. It's really a shame, though, that the script drops the ball on pretty much everything else. The story isn't just throwaway. It's total fucking garbage and makes no sense. There's nothing to spoil here. You've seen this plot many times before, and it's all laid out in the trailers anyway. One of the most egregious pieces of total nonsense is how Deadpool gets his powers. He's diagnosed with terminal cancer, but a shadowy organization approaches him saying they can cure him and grant him superpowers in the process. And indeed, the treatment unlocks his latent mutant powers, which just so happen to be mutant healing, which cures him of his cancer. But they had no way of speculating that that would happen. Ajax tells him that the powers could manifest in any number of ways, and he and Angel Dust had, as examples, received totally different powers from the same treatment. And they had no reason to try to lure Wade Wilson in with false promises, because if his cancer weren't cured, then he would be useless to them, because he would be dead. On a related note, Ajax is supposed to have superhuman reflexes, but Deadpool bests him in hand-to-hand combat on multiple occasions? Deadpool just heals wounds faster, whereas Ajax should be able to parry his every move and never get hit in the first place. The only reasonable way Deadpool should actually be able to win a fight would be through attrition, or some unforeseen crazy tactic to outsmart him, which would have been more entertaining to watch anyway. Plus, for someone who's supposed to have no emotions, Ajax sure holds onto grudges pretty vindictively. It's also pretty unfortunate that most of the characters, other than Deadpool, are just plain awful. Vanessa starts out as an interesting, unique, strong-willed woman, but devolves into generic lovey-dovey fiancé, and finally into damsel in distress. Ajax is just evil for evil's sake, and Angel Dust just really doesn't do anything, aside from what Master tells her to do. Perhaps they didn't want to give her a whole lot of lines, since she's an MMA fighter and not an actress by trade, but she does totally fine with the lines she does have. Apparently there were originally supposed to be 3 henchmen, and they had to condense them into 1 for budgetary reasons. I don't want to think of how it would have looked with her no personality stretched into 3 people. I could go on. The quote-unquote plot twist near the end was so predictable, I'm not even sure I can call it a plot twist. I don't know why shoving Vanessa in an oxygen deprivation chamber magically protected her from a several-story fall. Why would a cabbie purposefully pick up a patron multiple times who has a history of not paying? The plot is rife with problems, both big and small, but honestly, the positives of the film do outweigh the negatives. I'm not saying it was so funny I didn't care that it made no sense, but it was entertaining enough that it's worth watching despite its issues. The action is really fun, especially since it's got an R-rated edge most comic book movies don't get. The CGI is hit or miss. Sometimes it blended in fine with the live action, but sometimes it ended up looking really cartoony. But it's not really that bothersome, especially since they make fun of the low budget multiple times in the film. The best part of the movie, though, is its potential impact on the industry. It proved that an R rating isn't a death sentence for an action movie without The Matrix in its title. It had a smaller budget than other big R-rated comic book movies like Watchmen or Kingsman, but it made more in its first weekend than any other did in its entire run. Even compared to first weekends of PG-13 comic book movies, it really only has The Avengers to compete with. In fact, right now, after a week and a half, it's the sixth highest grossing R-rated film of all time, and I would bet by the end of its run it'll be at least number three. And it didn't do this by being a very tame R. No, it's filthy. It's really profane, really violent, really naughty. And if anything, it's a selling point instead of a deterrent. This is an especially big victory because it proves that all the executives that wanted to compromise it and lower the rating were wrong. Not only proving that their judgment isn't foolproof, especially since it's Fox, who has a history of executives fucking with the director's vision and ruining franchises, but that they don't need to be afraid of the R rating in the future. In fact, right on cue, it's looking like the third and final Wolverine solo movie will be R-rated, and Cable's inclusion in Deadpool's sequel might pave the way to an X-Force movie, which would be awesome, assuming it's done right. My only hope is that this doesn't become a fad, though I think studios can learn from Deadpool's success and continue to make successful R-rated comic book movies. Deadpool is a bit of an anomaly. Part of its success is definitely due to its marketing campaign, which was almost funnier than the movie itself. And the rating just won't work with every franchise. Making, for example, The Avengers into an R just to ride the bandwagon would be as damaging as dumbing Deadpool down to a PG-13 would have been. When Nolan's Batman trilogy was successful, it started a fad of gritty realism in comic book movies that didn't always work. It's probably what caused Spider-Man 3 to be what it was. It was probably part of the problem with the newest Fantastic Four, and it made Warner Brothers prematurely decide that their DC universe would be all serious all the time. When Disney garnered success with a more comedic approach with films like Iron Man and the Avengers, started a trend of action comedy comic book films. Almost all of their output since has had humor as a major factor. Thor, Ant-Man, Guardians of the Galaxy, with mixed success. And it made Warner renege on their serious DC universe with Suicide Squad, whose most recent trailer is clearly trying to imitate Guardians. As long as it's not overused, an R rating could open doors to a wider array of artistic possibility. I think Disney is doing the best job so far of recognizing that each IP is best approached in different ways. Though the majority of their output is comedic, Captain America Winter Soldier was more of a spy thriller, and I doubt Doctor Strange will be particularly funny given that it's directed by Scott Derrickson, whose output to date rests wholly within the horror genre. They've been doing a really good job picking people to helm their future films. Ryan Coogler's had really impressive output so far, and I'm excited to see what he'll do with Black Panther. Taika Waititi was a perfect choice to solidify Thor as one of the more comedic entries, and we'll see what the direction the Russo brothers take the Avengers in, now that they hold the reins. I think if WB and Fox can get the right person driving the big picture in the right direction, like Disney's Kevin Feige, the oncoming inundation of comic book films in the next 5 years could be a prosperous time of artistic bounty! Or it could get old fast and totally collapse, what do I fucking know?